Right, good morning everyone. Is everyone sort of sitting comfortably? A couple of levels okay in the room? Yeah. Can everyone hear me alright? Good. Alright, just to quickly introduce myself, my name's Michael Rhodes from MediaTek. I've got over 20 years experience in the IT industry. I've served in a number of positions throughout my career. I've got a number of certifications from organizations like CompTIA, Microsoft, and other bodies. One of the areas I've spent quite a lot of time in throughout my career is PC technician. So today we're going to sort of discuss the PC hardware components. All right, the objectives for our class today, after this presentation, students will be able to identify and describe personal computer components and system components. Okay. We're not specifically interested in exactly how they work. We can cover that in later classes. But like I say, the main motive for being here today is to simply describe these components and name them. So this is the agenda. As far as the hardware components goes, we're going to split it down into two areas, like the personal computer components, and as I mentioned, the system unit components. I took a look at the pre-course survey that everyone submitted, and obviously you have the IT experience, so we'll probably move fairly quickly through the personal computer components and focus more on the system unit components. All right, so a typical personal computer. So we have like an external device, like these speakers, printers. The system unit, okay, that is the correct term. Okay, as far as we're concerned on this course today, system unit is the correct term. Obviously a lot of people refer to it as the box, the tower, the mini tower, the hard drive, the CPU, okay. But like I say, the system unit. The input devices, keyboard, mouse, inputting the data, and the display device, the monitor, okay, for outputting our information. Okay. As you can see displayed, we've got an older type CRT monitor, you know, the cathode ray tubes. Obviously nowadays these are sort of slowly fading away, okay, so nowadays we see more of the LCD. Can anyone tell me what LCD stands for? Yes, sir.
Liquid crystal display.
That's correct. Liquid crystal display. Okay. So why do you think that these LCD monitors might be more popular nowadays?
Save power.
Save power. They're more energy efficient. That's good.
They're brighter.
They're brighter. Okay. So they cut down on the glare.
Smaller.
That's right, they have a smaller footprint on the desktop. Any other sort of considerations when it comes to these LCD monitors?
They look better.
They do indeed. So, yeah, they look better. But, one other sort of area as well is the fact that they're more environmentally friendly. These CRT monitors, these cathode ray tubes, I mean, they contain lead, and all sorts of other hazardous material. Okay, obviously the newer LCDs are a lot more environmentally friendly. All right, just one or two external devices that we may see on or around the desktop. Okay, things like microphones, digital cameras, scanners, speakers, printers, and external drives. So this looks like an iAmiga, Zip or Jazz drive. Anyone think of any other devices that we may see around the desktop in the workplace?
MP3 player.
MP3 player. It's good.
I was going to say a game controller, but then you said in the workplace.
No, I've seen it before.
Oh, all right.
Well, that's
maybe
true.
Maybe I'm a game tester.
Yeah. So not necessarily in the workplace. You know, any devices you can think of that we may see in the workplace or at home.
Cell phone.
Cell phone.
Voice recorder.
Voice recorder.
PDAs.
PDAs. That's right. So obviously nowadays, with these PDAs, Blackberries, things like that. You know, there's a lot of interconnection between the personal computer and the cell phones and PDAs. All right, so just to review what we've covered so far. This object here on the desktop, what's the correct term for that?
System unit.
Good. Okay. Nowadays, why are LCDs more popular than the older CRTs?
Environmentally friendly.
Smaller
footprint. Good.
Look better.
They look better. Okay, good. All right, we're going to move on and take a look at the system unit. Okay, so as you can see, I've got a system unit right here on this desktop. Okay, so we're just going to take a look at some of the major components. So right here we've got the power supply. Okay, so this power supply in a PC, it really acts as like a transformer. So, you know, the power that comes in from the wall is AC power, alternating current. So it comes into the machine, and this power supply converts it into DC power. The computer components need direct current. Okay, so like we said, it's sort of acting like a transformer. Over here we've got a couple of drives. We've got like an optical drive, CD drive, okay, playing CDs, DVDs. And then further down we've got the hard disk, the hard drive. So just a couple of drives that we'll see inside these system units. Also as well, we've got obviously the metal chassis, the frame. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to take out this motherboard. As you can see, I've got an ESD wristband for electrostatic. Okay. Whenever you touch any component inside this system unit, always make sure you're wearing an electrostatic wristband. Okay. You don't want to zap any of these internal components. Okay. These are delicate components. So what we can do is as humans, if we're if we're moving around, if we're running up and down in the corridor, charging around, we can build up, electricity, voltage in our bodies. Okay, so if we've just been running up and down the corridor, we come in here, we go inside the system unit and pick up the motherboard or an expansion card or a memory module, something like that. We can destroy it. Okay, what we're doing is we're transferring the voltage from our bodies to that particular component. Okay? Like I say, these components are very delicate. Okay? So they can easily be destroyed by static discharge. So this wristband, it puts us on the same, what it will do is it will ground us. So it will put us on the same electrical potential as any component that we touch. Okay? So by wearing this wristband, we're slowly draining the electrons out of our body and grounding ourselves.
Where can you get one of those?
Any PC repair shop, or even DIY stores, they sell them as well. So they're easily available. So what you see a lot of techs do is that another method you'll see is that every so often they'll touch the frame, the chassis, to ground themselves. Okay, that works, but as far as best practice goes, you really need to be wearing an electrostatic wristband like I have on. Okay. So I'm just going to go in here, and as you can see, I sort of unscrewed this before the class. So this is like one of these cooking shows where everything's ready beforehand. Having just talked for a minute about electrostatic wristbands, I'm actually going to take mine off. This is an old machine, it's out of service. Okay, this motherboard, all the components on this motherboard are never going to be used again. Okay, so I feel quite safe in in removing this, this wristband. But as I mentioned, any device, any machine that's in service, okay, must wear this at all times. All right, so we're going to take a look around the this motherboard or system board. Okay. So first of all, the ports. Can everyone see this? Okay, a clear view of. Yeah, I mean, as you can see, it's up on the overhead as well. So we've got the ports on the back. Okay, so we've got like a parallel port. Anyone think of what we might use that for?
Printer.
Zip drive. Okay. So the parallel port for hooking up any parallel device. Okay. It's sort of synonymous with the printer. In fact, a lot of people refer to it as the printer port. Okay. We've got a couple of the serial ports here. Okay. Obviously, the serial port, again, is sort of fading away a bit. You know, nowadays we've got newer technology like USB, FireWire. But anyone think of anything we could hook up to a serial port?
Mouse or keyboard?
A mouse, that's right. Years ago.
Modems.
External modem.
Okay, so like years ago, the mouse was a serial device. And a serial connector. External modems, that's correct. We've got a couple of USB ports. Okay, universal serial bus, obviously well used nowadays. What sort of devices could we hook up to these ports?
PDA.
Thumb drive,
flash drive, good.
Keyboard, mouse.
iPod.
Coffee mug heater, even. They make
coffee mug heater.
Reading light.
So, you know, as you can see, nowadays there are many USB devices out there. We've got the PS2 ports as well, you know, for the keyboard and mouse, color coded. Keyboard purple, mouse green. Okay. This particular motherboard as well, it also has like an onboard sound card. Okay, so when we say onboard, it means it's integrated into the motherboard rather than a separate expansion card that would slot in. Okay, so it's got an onboard sound card with a sort of game port or joystick port as well. Okay. What I'm going to do is actually, just so you've got a better view, I'm just going to sort of slide out this this network card and also this graphics card. All right, so just one or two other components that we've got on the motherboard. So we've got the CPU, okay, the central processing unit. Okay, this is like the brain of the computer. Okay, anyone name any CPU types that we see out there today?
Intel.
AMD. So that's right. Intel, AMD, they're probably the two most popular processor manufacturers. Okay, what about models?
Intel Pentium,
good. Any others?
Athlon.
AMD Athlon.
Centrino
really is like a mobile technology. So Centrino isn't actually a processor. It's sort of, as far as laptops go, it's the whole package really. It was like the processor, the battery, the wireless antenna. So when we refer to Centrino, that's really, it's all encompassing. It's really the mobile technology.
Just the chip.
That's correct, yeah. All right, so the processor. Just over here we've got the memory, the RAM modules. Okay, so we'll talk about RAM a little bit later on. Further down here we've got the expansion slots. So these motherboards are designed to be customized. Okay, so you can go out there and you can buy expansion cards, adapter cards, that we can slide into these expansion slots. This particular motherboard, we've got like the PCI slots, and we've also got like an older ISA slot as well, these legacy devices. Okay, so anyone think of any types of expansion cards that we could slot in here?
Network card.
Video.
Video.
TV tuner.
T TV tuner.
SCSI card.
SCSI card, like a host bus adapter. So that's right, I mean, you know, you go into any computer store nowadays, you know, all these different expansion cards. And it's exactly that, you're expanding the functionality of your machine. Also as well, this motherboard, we've got a couple of drive connectors or IDE connectors. Can you all see that? The two IDE connectors here. So that's correct. Yeah, the blue, that's usually IDE1, and the white, that's usually IDE2. So, you know, if we want to connect our hard drive, or optical drives, CD drives, DVD drives, you know, we're just going to connect them using these IDE connectors and obviously a data cable. What we've also got as well, I just want to sort of get in a bit deeper here, is just to take a look at the motherboard itself. We've got the what they call the chipset. Can everyone see these two chips right here? So the largest chips on the motherboard. So this is the chipset. So these are commonly referred to as the North Bridge and the South Bridge. The North Bridge, this sort of, when the CPU communicates with the RAM and also any video cards like a AGP card, accelerated graphics port, that's actually an AGP slot right there, or a PCI Express card, it's communicating through this chip right here, the North Bridge. Okay? So all the data, all the ones and zeros, are flying between the CPU, the RAM, and any video cards, AGP cards, PCI Express cards, all that communication is going through this chip right here. Okay. Further down the motherboard, as you can see, we've got this chip. This is commonly referred to as the South Bridge. Okay. So the CPU, if it wants to communicate with other components, if it wants to communicate with like these expansion slots, these IDE connectors, the drives, the ports, all that communication takes place via the South Bridge. Okay, so these two chips, the North Bridge and the South Bridge, they act as like hubs. You know, they channel the communication between the CPU and all these other devices that we find on the motherboard. All right, as I mentioned. Earlier on, obviously, I just took out this network card. Okay, so you can come up and take a look at this later on. And also, this, as I mentioned, this AGP video card. And again, you know, let me take a break and come up and just examine those components. All right, so just to recap what we've covered so far as the system board goes. We've got the CPU. How do we describe the CPU on this board? What analogy did I use?
The brains.
The brain, good. It's the brain of the computer. Okay. These PCI slots down here, what did we say they were used for?
Expanding the computer.
That's right. So expanding the functionality of this machine. Okay. This chip right here, what's this called?
North Bridge.
The North Bridge, good. What communicates via the North Bridge?
CPU and the memory.
CPU and memory?
And
video. Very good. How about this chip down here?
South Bridge.
The South Bridge. Very good. And again, what communicates via this particular chip?
The expansion slots. And the CPU.
CPU, the expansion slots, anything else?
Ports.
The ports, that's right. Any other components? One other component I mentioned.
The data ports for the IDE.
The drives, that's correct, the IDE. The IDE connectors. Okay, good. You seem to have a good grasp on those components. So that's basically what we're going to cover today. Just an overview of the personal computer components, system unit components. Do you have any questions or comments or concerns about anything we've covered? You'll feel comfortable with what we've discussed? Okay, good. If there's any follow-up after class, you can see I've got my contact number up there, also my email address. So any queries, any follow-up, please feel free to contact me. All right, thank you for your attention.